switch them to the slides if they would come back. Zumba tonight with Abby. And Ben Frederick is sharing on friendship tonight at Deeper. And then you'll remember that we have Chapel Friday with Tim Delina. And then also Friday evening, Tim's going to be with us for a worship night, revival night. That'll be incredible. And then I'm grateful to SJA, who's going to provide some cider donuts there in the lobby at 7, so come early. Drama department production this weekend and next weekend. Both soccer teams are still in the tournament. The women are playing here Saturday at 3 versus Iwu. And it's only 121 days until spring break, so it's time to plan on spring break mission trips, which are going to Kentucky, Hamtramck, Puerto Rico, here in Jackson, and Mexico. And if you need prayer this morning, you know where to come. And introducing our speaker this morning is Guthrie Collins. Guthrie's on the golf team, RA on Village G, and a senior.
All right. So the speaker today is my dad. He's the pastor of, of Shoreline Community Church in Muskegon. He has spoken all around the world. He just got his doctorate from Grace Theological Seminary. But more important than that, he has always put our family first with his ministry. And he's one of my best friends, and I'm excited that he's here today. So, it's my dad.
Good. Jerry, come on down front. Let's stand for worship and prayer. Prayer guys, come on down. Let's gather around Jerry. Guthrie is going to lead us in prayer in just a minute. Come on down closer here. Gather in. Okay, prayer guys, let's lift up our voices in prayer as we pray for Jerry, chapel this morning, this week, anticipating Friday night, chapel on Friday, ministries here on campus. Let's lift up our voices in prayer.
Dear God, thank you so much for this day. Thank you so much for dying on the cross for us, Lord. Thank you for this opportunity to gather here at chapel. I pray that you give my dad the words to say, and I pray for Deeper tonight that you give Ben the words to say to the student body as well. Lord, I pray that you show up today. Lord, show up in a big way and help us to become more like you. Help us to love you more, and we love you so much. Amen.
Thank you. complete. Jesus died, my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat. 'Cause Jesus paid it all. Oh, to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. Oh, praise the one who came my death.
Of every blessing, and tune my heart to sing thy grace, and streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious song, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise a mountain fixed upon it, mount of God's unthinking love. And here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I come. And I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home.
Jesus saw it.
'Cause Jesus saw me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. And he to rescue me from danger, and to post his precious blood. Let God work on your hearts. How great a tender, the daily unconstrained to be. Let thy grace now like a feather bind my wandering heart to thee, and prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. And prone to leave the God I love. And here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Prone to wander. And prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. And prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. And teach me some melodious harmony, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of God's unchanging love.
A thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night. You tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a gift. Good Father, it's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I am loved by you, it's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am, and I've seen many.
Well, good morning. Nice to be with you today. Thank you for the opportunity for me to come and share God's word with you. And if you'd like, I'm going to be sharing some thoughts from Proverbs chapter 4. I've been teaching through the book of Proverbs recently, and the other day I happened to be on the internet, and for some reason I was riveted by some of the text and driving YouTube videos that I'm sure many of you, if not all of you, have noticed and seen before. As I watched those videos, saw the byline at the end of the video said something like this: if you're texting, you're not driving. Another one said, no texts, no wrecks. They were sobering messages. The unfortunate reality is texting and driving yields carnage and wreckage, destroys people's lives. I would suspect that some of you here in this room know of someone, or you have personally been the victim of or experienced in your sphere of influence the carnage related to texting and driving. Well, as I was looking at these videos, being moved by them, thinking them through, it came to my attention that in many ways, those videos remind me of the book of Proverbs. Actually, in Proverbs chapter 4, I'm not going to focus on these verses, but in verses 25 and 26, here's what it says. Let your eyes look directly ahead, and let your gaze be fixed straight in front of you. Watch the path of your feet, and all your ways will be established. As I thought about that, I think what Solomon was saying is, do not text while you're living your life. Don't text while you live your life. Don't find yourself distracted. Keep wisdom in front of you. It will serve you well. It will keep you out of carnage. It will force you to take responsibility for your life instead of having to deal with consequences that may be with you for the rest of your life. Keep your eyes on wisdom. Otherwise, you'll be distracted by the wisdom of the world. You'll end up swerving here. You'll end up swerving there. And that distraction will force you, force your hand, force your time, force your energy into doing damage control. If there's anything I understand about Scripture, it's that God does not want you to live a life of damage control, spiritually or personally. It's easy to get there. We all know of people that have crashed and burned. Maybe some of you have experienced consequences in your life that you never want to visit again. Well, Solomon has a word for you this morning. He says the way that you get there is by the application of wisdom in your life. What is wisdom? Well, I'm suggesting that wisdom is the knowledge and understanding of life's usual patterns, and then the skillful application of that knowledge and understanding into every one of your life situations. Basically, it's sanctified common sense. It's the ability to know how life usually works out most of the time, and then based on that knowledge and understanding, you put that to work in your life. That's wisdom. Solomon wanted to instill this wisdom in the life of his son, his extended family, and so he takes Proverbs and he insightfully attempts to instill this thinking in the lives of those closest to him. He takes the time to explain, for instance, the content of wisdom in Proverbs, and then he compares and contrasts that with folly, with foolishness, desiring that his adult children would adopt this wisdom, both as a preventative and a foundation for their own lives. So Proverbs is about wisdom. It's not about maturity. Solomon has a lot to say about maturity, but he deals with that in the book of Ecclesiastes and the Song of Solomon. One cannot have maturity without developing wisdom first. You cannot get to maturity by bypassing wisdom. You must establish wisdom in your life. Wisdom, the knowledge and understanding of life's usual patterns, is necessary because it will keep you out of chaos. And don't we need that? You don't want chaos in your life. Chaos is destructive. Chaos tears apart. It doesn't build up. Chaos means I'm always having to figure out how to get by and get through. I never can seem to take charge of things because things keep overrunning and catching me, and I find it difficult to manage. And Solomon says, don't let that happen. First, you must establish wisdom in your life, because that's the foundation for maturity. So wisdom does two things for you. Number one, it prevents chaos. And number two, it provides a foundation upon which you can pursue maturity. And let me say something about that. As I understand the New Testament, the emphasis of the New Testament is about pursuing spiritual maturity. In Colossians chapter 1, verse 28, the Apostle Paul says to the Colossians, listen, I admonish every man, and I'm teaching every person with all wisdom, that I may present every person as mature in Christ. Do you know what he's saying? What he's saying is the whole basis and purpose of his ministry was to produce spiritually mature believers. You see, the New Testament isn't just about getting into heaven. Of course, we sung about that this morning, and the only way you can get in scripturally is through the cross of Jesus Christ. You place your faith in Jesus Christ, you accept his provision for your sin, and God says, I will give you the gift of eternal life. But that's just the beginning. You must move beyond the cross toward an empty tomb and recognize that you've now been empowered by the resurrection of Jesus Christ through the presence of the Holy Spirit in your life to pursue your spiritual maturity. It's not so much about getting into heaven as it is preparing yourself for the heaven you're going to. And Solomon says in the Old Testament, the way you do that is by appropriating wisdom, assimilating wisdom into your life. But the path to wisdom is different than the path to maturity. That's Proverbs. Wisdom is about bringing our chaos to order, our randomness to regularity. It's about bringing our confusion to a point of understanding. Wisdom is living in light of the usual patterns of life. Solomon's focus in this book is putting the fear of God into the lives of his sons so they can avoid the chaos of things like being a sluggard, acting naive, gaining dishonestly, or following the adulterous woman. That's Proverbs. In Proverbs, ignorance is not bliss. Being naive is a vice. It's not a virtue. We're to be knowledgeable, God says, but not gullible. We're to be insightful and not ignorant. Solomon does not want us to look at worldly wisdom through rose-colored glasses, as if we can somehow take some of the world's wisdom and some of God's wisdom and somehow blend them together into a hybrid wisdom that works. Now, Solomon says that's not possible. That's Proverbs. Wisdom prevents you from swerving into chaos. You know, violating life's usual patterns, if you choose not to be wise and you violate life's usual patterns according to the book of Proverbs, then Proverbs calls you a fool. A fool plays the percentages. A fool says, yeah, I know how life usually works, but in this case, I think I'm going to go this direction. I'm going to play the percentages. And I'm going to assume that life's usual patterns won't come to haunt me or to bite me in some way. Fools text while living. That's what they do. They play the percentages. They excuse the usual patterns of life and somehow think, in this case, it'll work for me. And when you do that, Solomon says to his sons, you're inviting mayhem into your life. You know the mayhem commercials? Think about that. That's a great picture of a life that chooses to avoid wisdom. And he says, you invite mayhem into your life, and then all you are is preoccupied with damage control. All of your life, energy, efforts, and resources are focused on controlling the damage that's been caused. You had to live with that. What about people that are fools that you've grown up with, or maybe in your own family or in your spheres of influence? What have you had to deal with because of their foolishness? You see, they violated life's usual patterns and decided to play the percentages, and now you have to suffer the consequences of those choices. It's not a pretty picture. Nobody sins in isolation. That's Proverbs. He warns his sons not to go there. Wisdom provides a foundation to create a uniform life that has regularity to it. It's the opposite of chaos. Instead of violating life's usual patterns, one instead chooses to establish his or her life on those patterns. This ends up developing order and continuity in your life, and there's symmetry to your life. And this foundation allows you now to take advantage of wisdom's benefits. Solomon delineates these benefits throughout Proverbs as a motivation for his sons and daughters and extended family to pursue this wisdom. Now in Proverbs chapter 4, I'm going to focus for a moment on the first 9 verses. What you're going to see in these 9 verses is some of what I've already told you. Solomon's appeal to you this morning is about your need for wisdom. Many of you are about some of the ages of the very sons he's talking to and he's writing to in the book of Proverbs. So you would fit very well into this appeal. You need this wisdom more than you think, I can guarantee it. You need it desperately. You actually need it urgently. And Solomon's going to tell you, get it at all costs. Don't avoid it, or you will regret it. Now, you've lived young enough that you don't have a whole lot of regrets. You have some, I'm sure. But if you don't get a hold of wisdom, you're going to live with a lot more. And so Solomon says in the 9 verses, these first 9 verses, this. Here's the point. If he was up here this morning pleading his case, I hope I'm being accurate and I'm not putting words in his mouth, but I think this is what he would say to you in these first 9 verses. You need to embrace wisdom as you live your life. Embrace it. That's what you need to do. And I'm going to suggest there are 3 things that follow if you choose to do that. First of all, in the first 4 verses, he says, do so because wisdom is essential for life. Let me read for you. Hear, O sons, the instruction of a father, and give attention that you may gain understanding. For I give you sound teaching. Do not abandon my instruction. When I was a son to my father, tender and the only son in the sight of my mother, then he taught me and said to me, let your heart hold fast my words, keep my commandments and live. So I suggest to you, embrace wisdom all of your life because it's essential for your life. In verse 1, it comes from instruction. That's how you get it. It begins with instruction. And then he says the instruction leads to understanding. One must hear, he says, and give attention, he says, to the instruction in order to gain that understanding. Now, fools ignore instruction. Because they ignore instruction, they have no possibility of getting to understanding. Understanding is the link between hearing something and reproducing something. If you can't reproduce what you've heard, you don't understand it. If you take up golf and you've never golfed before, somebody can give you all of the instructions they want, but you're going to look like I don't know what. You're not going to look like a golfer anyway if you're teeing off because you don't know what you don't know about it. There's no you've been told things, but you have no understanding, so you can't execute. If you like computer games, huh? Some of you like computer games out there? I understand that Black Ops 3 is coming out Friday. Yeah. See? I sounded like I knew something about what I said, but I don't know anything about it. All I know is my son told me about it, so I thought I'd use it. I know nothing. So you know what? I don't even know what I don't know about computer games. I have no understanding. So I can't reproduce anything. And Solomon says to his sons, listen, you need to hear what I say. You need to understand the instructions so you can put it to use. You can reproduce it. In verse 2, he says that the teaching that they've received, he describes it as sound teaching. Sound teaching. Don't abandon my instruction, he says. Why would he say that?
I would suggest he would say it because he knows his children are going to be exposed to rival wisdom. And so he says to them while he's having a cup of coffee, in one of his teachable moments, he says, listen, you got to believe what I'm telling you is true. It's sound wisdom. I'm not just spouting off. I'm not just giving you my opinions. I'm telling you about life's usual patterns, and I want you to own it. And he says in the end of the verse, don't abandon it. Because I know there's going to be rival ideology out there that's going to want to take the wisdom I've taught you and twist it out of shape and bend it out of shape so that you question it, become a skeptic of it, and eventually trade it in. He said, don't do that. He knows what the world's going to be like when his kids are out there. He's no dummy. He's been there himself. In verse 3 and 4, he reflects for a moment, which I find interesting. If you remember when I read it here, he said, you know, when I was a son to my father, well, you know who his father was? It was David. And then he says, tender and the only son in the sight of my mother, Bathsheba. It's interesting that Solomon stops for a moment and lets us in a little bit as he reflects, as he's talking to his boys and his extended family, and he says, you know, this happened to me. My mom and dad, they taught me. They took the initiative so that I learned wisdom from my parents. My mom and dad. It seems to me that the Bible keeps coming back to the idea that wisdom should be instilled through the home. That in the home is where it should be. And the outcome of this, he says in verse 4, is that you will live. You will live. But notice the progression now. In verse 1, from hearing to verse 4, holding fast. From verse 1, giving attention to verse 4, keeping this instruction. You know, parents are responsible, I believe, to establish boundaries for their children that teach them the knowledge and understanding of the regular patterns of life. That's what discipline's all about. As the children get older, the boundaries expand till eventually you're creating your own boundaries. You know, you're responsible for yours. And that's what parenting's all about. So what's the takeaway from this first point? Embrace wisdom because it's essential for life. The takeaway is this. Apparently, wisdom must be fought for. Beginning at home while growing up with parents who take charge to instill this knowledge and understanding of life's usual patterns at home. Then as young people and young adults who become challenged by rival worldly wise ideology, you can adopt your own perspective and your own boundaries and apply that wisdom into your life because wisdom is not natural. It must be taught and learned. You're not born with it. You must embrace it for life. Here's what he says in verses 5 and 6. Embrace wisdom not only because it's needed for life, but embrace wisdom because it's needed in daily life. Not just in life. You know, we do these 5-year plans about our lives. I don't know if you do. You might do it now because you're in college, and you might have a course that tells you you have to do that. But I've done that many times. And sometimes I will kind of sketch on a sheet of paper how old I hope to live. Okay, so I'll put, you know, 110, whatever. Be a little more realistic than that. And then I go backward from that age to where I am today. I am years of age. So between that and I say to myself, that's how much time I have to live, Lord willing. It's amazing how it shrinks more quickly at this stage. But that's what I have. Lord willing, that's what I have. And then I make a plan. I say, okay, over the next, let's say, 5 years, I want to do this. You know, maybe in the next 10, I hope to do that. Now when I get to 20, it gets a little iffy. And that's the first point. But the second point says, okay, what am I going to do today? See, wisdom is not only good for me in the long run, it's also good for me right now. And so he says in verse 5, the point is to get wisdom. Here's what he says, acquire wisdom. Acquire understanding. It's like, come on. It's almost like he's out of breath. Would you listen to me? Don't forget, don't turn away from the words of my mouth. The point is get wisdom, gain understanding. Don't let it slip away. Three times he shouts this. Again, later on in the chapter, he does the same. No matter the cost, no matter the energy expended, bogus wisdom abounds. So don't forget, my son. Don't turn away from it. Don't ignore what you learned on the farm. The wisdom in the city may seem relevant, but when you get there, you need to evaluate it based on the sound wisdom you've already received. You know, worldly wisdom has serious problems. I don't know if you've thought about this, but let me give you three of them. Worldly wisdom, first of all, is full of problems because there's no tolerance for biblical wisdom. There's no tolerance for biblical wisdom and worldly wisdom because there's no fear of God in worldly wisdom. So the Bible, God is nixed out of the equation. Worldly wisdom is devoid of God's wisdom. Secondly, worldly wisdom is inspired by Satan and demons. As a matter of fact, Paul says in 1 Timothy 4, verse 1, that as we approach the later days, we can expect demonically inspired doctrine to infiltrate into the world and through its wisdom impact societies at large. Thirdly, worldly wise refuse to confess or acknowledge sin. You know, pragmatism says you can identify sin by its consequences, and then all we have to do in Western society is fix the consequences so nobody has to deal with sin. God says you can identify sin by my commandments, by what my word says is sinful. So you'll have several choices to make throughout life. In verse 6, he says, while one is getting this wisdom into his or her system, the reason for not forsaking this wisdom is because she will serve you well. Verse 6 says this, do not forsake her, and she will guard you. Love her, and she will watch over you. He personifies wisdom as a lover. She will guard you, he says. She will walk beside you. She will warn you about approaching danger. Loving wisdom is like valuing her, a woman in this case, since he's talking to his sons, like a bride to be cherished and loved. And notice the desperate appeal for the need of this wisdom. He says, don't abandon her, verse 2. Don't forsake her, verse 5. Don't turn away from her. Verse 5, and don't forsake her again, verse 6. So what's the takeaway? You know, wisdom's good for the long view. Wisdom's good for daily life. Wisdom then provides practical protection in everyday life situations. Applying wisdom will keep you out of trouble. When you make wise decisions, you both benefit and you prevent. Wisdom is for life lived in the street, on the ground, where you live, where you work, where you raise your family, where you manage your time. He says, take it with you. It will serve you well in your daily life. One final thought. 7 to 9. Why should you embrace wisdom? It's good for the long haul. It's good for today. The third reason is in 7 to 9. Do so because it's the foundation to living well. To living well. Let me read the verses to you. Beginning in verse 7, the beginning of wisdom, or the primary thing about wisdom, is to acquire wisdom. And with all your acquiring, get understanding. Prize her. She will exalt you. She will honor you if you embrace her. She will place on your head a garland of grace. She will present you with a crown of beauty. Wow. So in verse 7, he says there's nothing more important than to acquire wisdom. Wisdom is the knowledge and understanding of life's usual patterns and the application of that knowledge and understanding into every one of my life situations. Solomon says, listen, there's nothing more important than that. And it should be done at all costs because it's of supreme value. One can only offer wisdom. You can't force feed it. Somebody must be willing to acquire it and receive it. So here's the appeal again and again. To receive and to take and to not forget wisdom. Linked to understanding, which allows you to put that to work in your life. And in 8 and 9, he personifies wisdom by calling her a prized, beautiful woman. And notice, if you have your text open, he says wisdom is described four times by the word she. What he's doing here is he's giving us four benefits. First, he says, she, in verse 8, will exalt you. She will exalt you. In other words, if you take wisdom to heart and you embrace it, wisdom will lift you up over the hurdles and barriers of life and the potholes that you may have to face and provide for you some practical application to work through in those situations. He says, secondly, she will honor you if you embrace her. So wisdom will give you honor. The idea here is that if you embrace wisdom, this has to do with the development of your character. You will be an honorable person, a person of character. Things like righteousness and prudence and peace, joyfulness, integrity, perspective will make your life honorable and not disgraceful. A few weeks ago, I was up north. I forget exactly when it was, may have been Labor Day weekend. And I was zooming down the road on a four-wheeler, and coming toward me was a friend of mine who had texted me the night before and asked me if I was going to be up there, and I didn't know if I was, so I never got back to him. So I stopped and turned the four-wheeler off, and we chatted a minute. We didn't really chat, I should say. I asked him, how you doing? And he stood there in silence. So I said, well, you know what, I'm going to sit here till he says something, because I know he's a joker, so he's just going to wait until to see if I speak again before he speaks. And he said nothing, and then I noticed he started crying. I saw his lips quivering. So I took my helmet off and I said, what's wrong? For the next hour, I heard a story of a man who had crashed and burned in his life, and it all came crashing down 4 days earlier when his wife received a message from a husband who told her that her husband had been involved with his wife. And basically, he had been acting out on pornography. He'd been in pornography for years and had been acting it out with this woman, and it just all came to light, and he stood there dribbling and crying, and his life is falling apart. Disgraceful. You don't want to go there. Do you ever want to stand before a friend and you've just crashed and burned and all you can do is weep and cry and look into an unknown future and wonder if life is ever going to work again? That's where you will go if you avoid wisdom. My friend for the past 2 months has been picking the pieces up, working through his issues. I have no idea what will end up in his case, but we're going to walk with him through it and see where it goes. He's willing. We'll see what happens. But Solomon says, listen, my sons and daughters, if you embrace wisdom, you will become honorable. Thirdly, he says, wisdom will make your life attractive. Verse 9, she will place on your head a garland of grace. The idea there is a garland represents reward and bounty. And then finally, if you will embrace her, the end of verse 9, she will become a crown of beauty to you. You will live a life of dignity. Dignity and appeal. No more hiding stuff. No more wondering if anybody's going to find out. No more, you know, being one person there and another. You'll be a real person. Dignity and appeal and integrity. That's what wisdom will do for you, but you got to believe it. You got to believe it in the long haul. You got to believe it today when you are forced to make decisions between pursuing God's wisdom or worldly wisdom, between pursuing wisdom lived on the ground from Solomon's point of view or wisdom lived on the ground from the world's point of view. So what's the takeaway? Wisdom is the basis for living life well. Without it, you move into chaos. The Bible never promotes a life of damage control. The scriptures teach that the trajectory of your life should be towards spiritual maturity. You get there as you adopt wisdom. So what? Let me give you three closing thoughts and we'll pray. Wisdom is learned from people who learned it. And then they equip you with it. So get people in your life who are wise and learn it from them. You're not born with it. It must be learned. Secondly, wisdom minimizes the baggage you will have to carry in life due to unwise decisions that produce the chaos that creates the baggage. Don't go there, please. Life's hard enough already. And finally,